All right, so I am Jack Halberstam, and I teach in New York City at Columbia. And what I want to present today for Grand Reunion comes out of a book that I just finished that's coming out in the fall called Wild Things, The Disorder of Desire. So I think you can see from the title, A New Kind of Wildness, which is a quote from a review of the original performance of the Rite of Spring in 1913, that, you know, I'm going to be thinking and talking and theorizing the category of wildness in relationship to this ballet that is unique, interesting, that is a kind of queer event that came and went, and that has had incredible resonances since its very few performances at the beginning of the last century, has had enormous resonance for queer performance and dance. Okay, so that's what we're doing. The second half of my title is An Aesthetics of Bewilderment. And if you think about bewilderment, it's such a great term, and it obviously holds within it a concept of wildness. So to be bewildered is to become wild, and is also to become lost. So there's obviously some connection here between getting lost and thinking differently and performing in unpredictable and surprising ways. So by the time we come around to the aesthetic of bewilderment, we're going to be talking about the indigenous material upon which Rite of Spring is based, but it is not always theorized as part of the newness of the ballet. So that's what we're going to do. I'm just going to, you know, since here we are in this weird moment, in this weird situation where we're semi-live, shall we say, this is a kind of cool situation where we're in a space, we're in the space of CounterPulse, there is an audience, there is a speaker, we're here together, we're for once not Zooming, and I will try to keep it sort of informal, go through the material, the basic argument that I want to make about Rite of Spring. And then who knows, maybe we can even have a little conversation afterwards, which would be amazing. So in this new book, Wild Things, I take this category of the wild and I argue, or I make clear, that wildness is a category that was produced really within modernism as the other to civilization, right? So if civilization, we know, was a kind of colonial way of supposedly improving non-modern cultures, then we've, at this point, we've developed very strong critiques of civilization. We no longer are invested in the notion of being civilized, and therefore, at this moment, the category of the wild gets freed up for as something that we can think with separately from that colonial logic. So there are a couple of different ways that I mean wild. One is that, you know, towards the end of the 19th century, and this has been theorized a lot by people like Michel Foucault, the end of the 19th century, a whole bevy of experts began to narrate a story about the world that involved putting everybody into categories and thinking deeply about classification itself. And so Foucault calls this the order of things, and he pushes it back to around about the 17th century, when people began to look at plant life and animal life and human life around the globe. Colonial wanderers and travelers began to classify the world. Foucault suggests that this is the beginning of a project that we could call the modern. But at the same time, not everything gets classified, right? And there's tons of experiences and tons of forms of life that escape the web of expertise. So even Foucault implies that if there's an order of things, there must also be a disorder. And that disorder, and we can see this even now in the way in which protesters are being characterized in this contemporary moment, disorder is always then associated with sort of people who need to be brought under control, people who have somehow gotten loose from the techniques of governance that are here to, quote unquote, protect us. So there's certain kinds of groups, certain forms of personhood, and certain categories of being that round out the category of the wild. So my proposal is simple. If we are at the very limits of a civilized a notion of civilization, and if we no longer believe in a civilized way of being, then the category of the wild should be newly interesting to us, and we should begin to investigate what we could call a disorder of things. That unruly morass of being, activity, plant life, animal life, and community that somehow either escaped or refused the web of classification from that earlier moment. Okay? That said, and let's move to a slide, and this is one of my texts in my book, Where the Wild Things Are, which I am not really allowed to show you any panels from because Where the Wild Things Are, Sendak's estate won't give me permission, so I'm showing you graffiti of it. We continue to use the category of wild in racial context. It continues to be applied to indigenous peoples. It continues, and this is what we're absolutely up in arms about today, to be applied to black people. This is a very, very particular use of the term. You go back to the Central Park Five, who were accused of wilding when they were falsely accused of the rape of a young woman in Central Park some 30, 40 years ago. We continue to use it as a racial category, but the other way we use the category of the wild is in relationship to animals and children. So you end up with a pretty interesting set of subaltern figures, if you like, who meet under the heading of wildness. Now, one way that we can access this wildness that has been completely suppressed by modernity is pretty obviously through art. And there are a number of different texts, and I'm going to show you some, that pull away the veil of this civilizing project and try to let loose some of the material that we've called wild or disorderly back into into music or into dance or into other places. And it gets quickly taken up as a kind of canonical inscription. But at the beginning of the 20th century, those kinds of aesthetic experiments were very disruptive. And so just think about someone like Adorno sneering at black jazz, where jazz was heard as a deeply disordered relationship to harmony. Harmony is the goal of a certain kind of Western investment in music. And jazz was seen as somehow wild in a not very pleasing way. So we're going to use the Rite of Spring, and I'll tell you why in a moment, to see if we can pull back the veneer of a civilized order of things and take a peek into the wild. Now this is kind of cool because, next slide, in terms of his very wild symphony, Stravinsky said of his work, "My music is best understood by children and animals." So there's that link that we've just described as being a link forged out of wildness. And this is a super cool comment. It's as if Stravinsky's saying, you know who doesn't object to my music, even if it hurt the ears of bourgeois culture at the beginning of the 20th century? You know who doesn't object to it? Children and animals. Because potentially, children, for example, hear the world differently. We know that children see the world differently. And just as an example, I've written about this in other places, children watch films over and over again. They don't tire of seeing them. Why? Because they're not attuned to plot. They're watching the parade of images in a kind of Deleuzean way. They're looking at color, they're looking at patterns, they're looking at certain comedic elements that adults don't see. So similarly, children are not necessarily disturbed by these ragged sounds that some composers have made into a kind of refusal of Western notions of harmony and symmetry. And animals, we know, listen to each other differently and have all kinds of noise-making activities that humans either can't hear or hear only as noise. So we're in that terrain of noise when we approach Stravinsky's original symphony. Now, this is quite a dangerous thing for Stravinsky to say, because Adorno, in particular, critiques Stravinsky's music as being immature, which which is super interesting again, right? This is such a high cultural dismissal that the music is childish, it's immature, which already makes a connection to a kind of queerness on the one hand, but also to a pre-modern culture of noisemaking on the other. Okay, so there's my, just a little slide of, you know, Pixar films have been my go-to text for thinking about this relationship and connection between animals and children that in Pixar films gets played out in super interesting ways, in often anarchistic ways, in that children are interested in defeating the hierarchies that imprison them, which in this world tend to be parents. So this notion of a soundtrack for the pre-human, the animal and the child, is of great interest. All right, let's jump into the Rite of Spring then. And the Rite of Spring is a good text to go to for the argument that I'm trying to make, precisely because when it was performed in 1913, it was, you know, this is the mythology of Rite of Spring, it was met by a riot, right? The Parisian audience, they didn't riot. This is a wholly bourgeois audience, and the audience were like, no, no, you know, this music sucks, and what these people are doing isn't ballet. But for those reasons, this is of great interest. Because it was rejected when it was performed, and by the way, it was only performed once or twice, it becomes interesting to us as a work that for a moment broke through this modernist high cultural project with the sounds of something else. And the fact that those sounds were then attributed to so-called pagan cultures allows for an investigation into what the indigenous has to do with wildness. So we'll get there. Jacques Rivière was one of the people who wrote a review of The Rite of Spring from the original performance. And what's amazing about that original performance, and by the way, you know, it was literally, I think, performed once or twice in 1913, and so it falls into the category of what José Muñoz calls queer ephemera. It's like a piece of performance art by Jack Smith or someone that lots of people know about, and some people were even there, but no one preserved it, right? It's completely unpreserved. Nijinsky did not write down the choreography. We have the music, but we have no film footage. We have the backdrops, the paintings from the backdrop. We have some costumes. And as you'll see, we then have a recreation of the ballet from some a recreation project that was then performed in the 80s by the Joffrey Ballet. But what the actual ballet was, no one actually knows. And that, again, makes it into a really cool text, because there isn't a text that is the canonical dance against which all other dances are going to be measured. There's only a fantasy of what that dance might have been. Jacques Rivière wrote in really amazing ways about this performance, and he said, "It's a piece of wreckage from the past, teeming, eaten through by a familiar and monstrous life." And there are a number of these kinds of over-the-top reviews, including there's a guy called Harry Kessler, who kept amazingly precise diaries. He was a sort of bon vivant from the turn of the last century, and he wandered around Europe. He's like a FOMO, or an original person suffering from FOMO. If something was happening somewhere, he went to it, okay? He was an aristocrat, he had money, he had time, he had energy. Off he went, and of course he was at Rite of Spring. And he was there with a coterie of other men who we would now classify as gay men. And he wrote it, therefore we have an account of this performance in Kessler's diary. And by the way, the Kessler diaries are insane. They have their own crazy story, because they were found, I think there was one volume that people knew of, and then when one day when someone died and their estate was being gone through, someone found in a safe all these other diaries by Harry Kessler. And he gives, and he's openly gay or open about having same-sex relations in this diary. And he went around Europe and did all kinds of activities, including May 29th, 1913, showed up in Paris, went to the premiere of Rite of Spring. And he wrote that he went to a rehearsal for it, and he said, oh my God, he wrote in the diary, this is going to be a scandal. This is going to be an absolute scandal. And he was right. He knew. He had his finger on the pulse of queer Europe, if you like, and indeed it was. So according to Kessler, when the ballet began, the audience was from the beginning, quote, restless, laughing, whistling, making jokes. And he says that the reason that this was happening was because people didn't know what to make of Nijinsky's choreography on the one hand, and on the other hand, Stravinsky's score. He tells us that the performance continued despite the progressive rising of what he called a crazy din. Like, the audience would not be quiet. People in the audience were just completely up in arms and began booing and hissing and throwing things. And then he wrote, and this is Harry Kessler, he writes in his diary, a thoroughly new vision, something never before seen, enthralling, persuasive, is suddenly there. And this is how he describes it. A new kind of wildness, both unart and art at the same time. All forms laid waste and new ones emerging suddenly from the chaos. And there it is, this idea that what we're seeing is not wild people and is not wild dance, but is wildness, wildness itself, something capturing something about this unruly force of energy that in the ballet is not exactly the human, but is much more spring. It's spring itself. The ballet is not the performance of a rite of spring simply, but many of the commentators on the ballet suggest that what's extraordinary about the ballet is that it captures the energy, the material energy of this season of renewal and blooming and blossoming and so on. Okay, Stravinsky, just sort of connecting him to this whole set of names of modernism into which he both fits comfortably and then at the same time doesn't fit, because he wrote something that was first rejected and then was accepted and was almost never simply positioned within modernism. First it was too weird and then it was too popular. Do you know what I mean? It's like one minute it can't be accepted by any metric, and then the next minute, oh, it's just a popular thing. It's part of the culture industry. It's not really modernist. But in fact, this is one of those few times where something new happened, okay? And there's that quote from Kessler, a thoroughly new vision, something never before seen, enthralling, persuasive, is suddenly there, a new kind of wildness, both unart and art at the same time, all forms laid waste, new ones suddenly emerging from the chaos. And of course, this was always the promise of modernism, was newness, which it only very rarely delivered on. But, and I'm not saying that the Rite of Spring, the symphony, completely delivers on the newness, but I am going to make the claim that the ballet itself does. And precisely because it has not really been allowed to enter into a canon, because we don't really know what it is. So this idea that the ballet is not about people, but is about spring itself, is then again captured by Jacques Rivière himself, the great commentator on Rite of Spring, from whom everyone sort of takes their cue. And he described it as the noise, the motion, and so on. Great swirling accumulations of protoplasm, germinating masses, zones, circles, placentas, the horrible work of the cells. It is as if we were watching the drama under the microscope. This is like a dance review, by the way, okay? People are reading this essay like, has this guy lost his mind? But this is a beautiful description, in fact, of the ballet in a format that we would now call new materialist, in the sense that new materialism believes that the human has centered themselves within this thing we call world, and has done so to the detriment of all the other things that are in action around us, one of which would be something that we vaguely understand as nature. But material life itself Riviere says is the subject of the ballet. Do you see? So the rite of spring, yes, it is a rite, but it's really about spring. So let's just dig into the ballet. Why was this such an amazing performance? Just to give you image, and this is from the original ballet. There are still some photographs left of the ways in which people were dressed in the ballet. You can see that it's an imaginary of some sort of, you know, tribal ritual. And so you have this, now we would, I think, be very uncomfortable with this characterization of indigeneity with all the tropes of stereotyping, not real costumes, not real clothes associated with any particular tribe, but more of just a Western take on indigeneity. But at any rate, this is an image from the beginning, from the staging of the Rite of Spring. So what was it about Rite of Spring that so offended? So keep in mind that we don't know what the Rite of Spring is. We will never know. We don't know what Nijinsky's choreography is. But two people tried to recreate Nijinsky's choreography. I think Millicent Dodson and Kenneth Archer. They're a very heteronormative couple. Millicent Dodson hired Kenneth Archer as her assistant, and they went through all of Nijinsky's notes and put together, to the best of their ability, what they could of what they think the ballet was. And then they got married, the two of them, Kenneth and Millicent, and then they referred to the recreation of the choreography as their baby. So it's got this super heteronormative orientation, which is really wrong because this is a very queer production, and I'll explain why in a moment. But I do want to play you a little bit of the Joffrey Ballet recreation from the notes of Dodson and Archer, because then we can start talking about what is the wildness of this ballet. Because if you go on and on about it, at a certain point people are going to be like, well, oh my God, I mean, what were people reacting to? And I do think if you just keep in mind that ballet, particularly at that time, ballet russe and the ballet scene on the Parisian stage is more in the along the lines of, you know, Swan Lake and graceful leaps across the stage and beautiful shapes and graceful architectures of the body. Okay, so let's watch this version. And you can see this on YouTube. All right, I'll just stop it there. So there are a couple of features of this choreography that were understood as offensive. One is the stance, which is pigeon-toed. You know, this is a classic, is this the first position in dance? Yeah. But this is the position in Nijinsky's choreography. And then, you know, the ways in which a ballet dancer leaves the ground are part and parcel of a kind of flowing, graceful movement across the floor. And these folks are jumping up and down, boom, 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 so that there's a kind of percussive element to the way in which the body's heavily and without that kind of almost light, floaty quality, just keep pounding up and down, so that the body actually, and many people who perform Rites of Spring in some version or another, the body is punished by its relationship to this beating up and down on the ground. And then there's, you know, the way in which the groups interact, these movements that are hunched forward very often rather than the opening into space. So You could say it was an anti-ballet, and it took all the elements that were understood to be the grammar of the time, of dance, and turned them inside out or inverted them, literally queered them. Okay, so I want to talk about the queerness in a second, but these are some of the people who, that's Harry Kessler, and he was there with, I can't remember all the people, but Cocteau, I think, and someone else, like the queer elite, the gay male underground of Paris went to this ballet. This was not, it wasn't an accidental audience. Gertrude Stein, who was in Paris at the time, claimed she went to see the performance. She did not, but she was not going to let the little historical fact that she hadn't been there get in the way of her writing about it and saying that she was. So all of queer Paris went to this performance. This was understood as a kind of queer event. But when the ballet and the music gets taken up into popular culture, you lose this whole kind of queer element. And that's what I want to put back in, along with an understanding of the unclassifiable nature of the queerness and the wildness that is the motor that pulls the whole thing together. Now, if you wanted a methodology for, well, what are you doing here? You just want to reread modernism? No, not really. What I want to do is more in line with what someone like Grail Marcus did with punk, which was to look at these moments in the 20th century where there's an eruption that shifts the course of cultural production and does so in a super wild way that chains and transforms what we think we mean by sound, for example, or music. And punk is a good example because, remember, there was the same sort of like, boo, no, we don't want to see this. You can't even play your damn guitar. You know, he can't sing. Why is he doing that, right? That kind of disturbance to bourgeois expectations is also what we could call wild. And of course, the queerness of the production. I mean, Diaghilev, Stravinsky, and Nijinsky. Stravinsky is, you know, had many, many relationships with women. Nobody would make a big claim about him being homosexual as such. But there are many rumors about his relationship with both Nijinsky and Diaghilev. And there's no question that Diaghilev and Nijinsky were involved in a relationship during this time. And after this, Nijinsky has his nervous breakdown, and his wife quickly hurries him off to a sanitarium, and that's sort of the end of it. Diaghilev, super interesting. He's like an early Andy Warhol. He was somebody, he had a training in music, but he knew he was not good enough to really be a musician. So he became a kind of wonderful MC, and he went around putting on events like this one. He made no bones about the fact that he was involved with men. He wrote about that at length. And at one point, he even goes to visit Kraft Ebing, who's one of the people who wrote about sexuality at the turn of the last century. And he says, oh, Kraft Ebing tells me that I'm suffering from a nervousness. But maybe so, but, you know, I'm going to continue in my relationships with men. It didn't bother him that he was being classified as pathological. On he went. So these folks were... Well, that's interesting. Why is that playing? Oh, okay. So I'm just playing you the music from Stravinsky. Just to say that this music, and I'm going to tell you why I think the music is queer, also is telling us about the relationships between these three men. Okay. Because I'm also suggesting that there's this deeply racialized component to the way in which we understand wildness, and I've made the argument about punk, but let's not forget that there are many, many moments in the history of black music that have also can be classified as wild. And I want to give you a really good example that comes up in the work of Fred Moten a lot. And this is Abby Lincoln singing with a piece of Max Roach's triptych, Prayer Protest Peace. And I think in this day and age, we can absolutely hear this performance now in a way that in 1964, it was, again, heard only as noise, disruption, something outrageous, something that should be stopped. Her performance was classified as dangerous, was compared to the politics of Malcolm X. What was that performance? Here it is. Ah!
So the performance in some places was banned, but I think given what's happening today, we understand how that is protest, how that occupies the category of protest. And I want to say that Rite of Spring can be heard through exactly that kind of open mouth scream, just an absolute refusal of what has been classified as beautiful, harmonious, right, civilized, as what you go to the symphony to hear, as what you go to the ballet to see. This, that was a great example of this kind of disruption that is available in certain moments through certain forms of aesthetic refusal. And the reason I brought up Grail Marcus is because Marcus looks for these moments of disruption and tells a history of the 20th century through them. And I think I'm trying to do the same thing with my category of the wild. And there's the stuff on punk. Here's another scream if you want it. And that this is how Marcus describes it. He says it's what story is he telling? A tale composed of incomplete sentences, voices cut off or falling silent, a tale of recapitulation staged again and again in different theaters, a map made altogether of dead ends. That's a great method. Let's write that history. Let's write history that way. Okay. All right. There is the some more images, the Rite of Spring. Yes, Millicent Hudson and Kenneth Archer, they're the couple who put it back together again. All right. And, you know, what we don't want to do is still and tame the wildness that we find in the ballet. What I'm trying to do through this queer reading is reimagine the queerness of that performance, not to restage it, not to go back to it, but just to sort of think about the energy that it unleashed upon the world. As Isadora Duncan said, you were once wild here, don't let them tame you. Okay, so let's just think about then the queerness of the wild, the queerness of this particular performance. And here again are some images from the Rite of Spring. And I think, so what would be queer, what's queer about it? Well, first of all, it's supposed to be a fertility ritual, right? You're supposed to have men and women dancing in this ritualistic way, making a sacrifice of a virgin so that the harvest will be good. We're supposed to be watching a fertility ritual. The male-bodied people and the female-bodied people in the dance almost never dance together. They're almost completely homosocially separate in the performance. So that's one way of thinking about it. In fact, heterosexuality is completely thwarted in this ballet and is pushed off to the side as an afterthought in many ways. Then the other thing that's queer is, you know, if harmony, symmetry is all part of this kind of reproductive order of things, then the queerness is also embedded in these gestures of awkward stance, angularity, a refusal of gracefulness. Gracefulness, which after all is passed out in certain ways to the conventionally male body and in other ways to the conventionally female body. So the fact that you have men, male-bodied people and female-bodied people on the stage jumping up and down, and the fact that in many queer versions of Rite of Spring, the chosen one, who in the original is a young female virgin, is often played by a gay man, you can see that there's sort of room here for a queer improvisation of what the ballet has set in motion. And again, Riviere says it well. He says, well, grace isn't just synonymous with roundness. It's not incompatible with angularity. There is grace here. So what Riviere wanted people to see, that he was convinced they could not, because he was at the performance where everyone booed the thing off the stage, was that the problem is that we only see grace according to these norms of bodily comportment, when in fact, Grace can be found in many, many different ways of holding the body, okay? And Rite of Spring shows this. It is a deeply charismatic text, even when you just see the Joffrey Ballet version, so charismatic that despite the fact that we don't know what it is, there are multiple performances of it from Pina Bausch to Bill T. Jones to Keith Hennessy and so on. In queer studies, many people have sort of contested the idea that we simply move from an unscripted understanding of sexuality in the 19th century to this binary ordering of desire in the 20th century into homo and hetero. And Pete Coviello is really a great theorist to think with about this topic, because he suggests that from about the late 19th century into the beginning of the 20th, lots of people haven't really come under the aegis of homo hetero. And so there are all kinds of people who are just languishing in indefinition. And that would be true of Nijinsky, Diaghilev, Stravinsky, our players in this particular drama. And so Coviello suggests that, queerness is of a piece with wildness. And he says, the extravagances that flourish in the space of a not yet congealed sexual specificity. So there's so much interesting material around the turn of the last century, precisely because this order of sexuality has not yet properly taken shape. And he says there are, and you can hear an echo of Grail Marcus here, the outlines of any number of broken off, uncreated futures that would not come to be. In other words, just because we think in terms of a homo hetero binary, even though we don't really anymore, we did for a long time, people who were not heterosexual at the turn of the last century might have imagined themselves into very different arrangements of bodies, desires, and relations than the ones we've come up with. And those are futures that never came to be. So we could put Rite of Spring in that category of a kind of outrageous manifestation of desiring subjects, bodies, and nature that has exceeded the terms that we have settled for in the 20th century in terms of regulating desire. Okay, this is a great image from some of the original sketches that were done for Rite of Spring, reminding us that the human is sort of nestled within the animal, and Keith Hennessy makes a big deal about this in his performance of Rite of Spring, which is called Bear/Skin, I believe. And here you have the bear skins and the human bodies that try to find themselves in animal form, suggesting that in other eras, people have had different relationships to animality and haven't made the stark separation between human and animal that upon which we are so dependent. And here's the chosen one and so on. Okay, so just to say that the sound of indigenous noise making is not accidental in Rite of Spring. Stravinsky, when he was writing his symphony, he claims to have gone around Russia and other parts of Eastern Europe, including Lithuania, and listened to folk music and imported some of those rhythms into Rite of Spring. Just as the ballet has imagined some version of so-called primitive society and then performed its understanding of those indigenous cultures. That said, so we want to look now for the signs of the importation of these indigenous sounds and indigenous cultures. But at the same time, before that, I just want to explain why I think the music itself is queer. And then we'll move on to close by thinking about indigeneity. And again, this is not something that people actually write about in relationship to Rite of Spring. This is not a conventional reading of Rite of Spring at all. The first chord, the first sound in Rite of Spring is a bassoon. And a bassoon is understood to be an instrument that plays in the low range and provides a kind of low miasmatic sound out of which other instruments emerge. But if I'm going to play this for you, you can hear that the bassoon in this symphony plays at the high end of the register. So the instrument is being perverted, literally, in terms of its specified function. So queer sound. Here's the bassoon. It's playing up here. It's supposed to play down here. And it's supposed to be the backdrop. People say it's very difficult for bassoon players to play this. It sort of stretches people, okay? But it is an inversion, and it has been written about as such by musical theorists who have written about Rite of Spring. They call the chord an inversion, but no one is making the connection to the queerness. So I'm not just saying, oh, the thing's queer because queer men made it. Not at all. The music itself is queer. The music, as are the choreographed moves, as are the stances, as is the arrangement of bodies. And then there's the percussion and the strings are reversed. Usually the percussion is in the background and the strings rise above. That relationship is reversed in Rite of Spring. And then you could say more about timing, but I think this will play the percussion. See how foreground the percussion. And that piece, by the way, this is used in Disney's Fantasia, you'll remember, for the dinosaur scene, which is totally out of step with the rest of Fantasia, which is colorful and beautiful. The dinosaur scene is all about extinction, which has a particular bearing upon the narrative about indigeneity that is embedded in the piece as a whole. So let's move then to this final piece talk about an aesthetics of bewilderment that I believe Rite of Spring sets in motion, and then gets interestingly taken up by queer indigenous artists later on. Rather than just being rejected, it actually becomes part of a queer indigenous refusal of modernism and even modernity. Okay, but before that, let's go back to the scene of the crime. So one critic Tamara Levitz, has written about what she thinks the riot was when Rite of Spring was performed for the first and possibly only time in May of 1913. And I'm gonna read you this quote. She says, "A detailed analysis of the soundscape at the premiere reveals that the ballet did not incite an angry riot because of its newness." She's just like, that's not it, as Gurdjieff and the musical establishment have come to believe, but rather provoked a xenophobic response from critics who associated the ballet with cultural practices of colonized people of color they considered racially inferior to themselves, and who reproduced everyday racist discourse about those people in their reviews. So, you know, if you go and read all of the, you know, the popular stuff on Rite of Spring, it's like, this is the ballet that provoked a riot. And you think that, oh, this is amazing. People were so riled up by this thing that they went and rioted. No, it's a riot of bourgeois sensibility. And Levitz details who was there, what she thinks that they were responding to. And she's absolutely convinced, from poring over eyewitness accounts about what happened in the Théâtre des Champs-Élysées that night, that the critics were responding to what they believed was the interruption of Western culture by an indigenous aesthetics that they literally find bewildering. Okay, and she writes, quote, "The dancers' noisy movements unsettled their notion of Western ballet, causing them to perceive the Rite as unbeautiful, uncivilized, and consequently, from their racially informed perspective, as created by non-Europeans lesser than themselves." And of course, Stravinsky had already told us, he went and listened to so-called pagan music to make the music. And it's clear that Nijinsky is drawing upon imagery of indigenous peoples to bring this whole story into being about a fertility rite. So there's no question that the Rite of Spring is a kind of Western take on indigeneity. It is kind of offensive, but in this case was offensive to the bourgeois audience who witnessed it. And for some contemporary indigenous artists, the Rite of Spring sort of persists as an interesting text. So there's something of indigenous culture that exceeds this framing of indigeneity within a modernist text. Okay, so let's move on then. And one way to read it, if people know queer indigenous scholar Jody Bird, who wrote a brilliant book called The Transit of Empire, suggests that when colonial cultures clash with indigenous cultures, it creates a kind of cacophonous result. And she uses this term cacophony precisely to describe the way in which the colonizer can't make sense of indigenous culture and hears indigenous culture simply as cacophony. That's how the people in the Théâtre des Champs-Élysées heard the Rite of Spring was as a cacophonous noise. But cacophony is precisely a form of noise making that the colonizer cannot decipher. All right, so finally, I want to move then to think about cacophony and bewilderment with and alongside the work of indigenous he's a queer Canadian Swampy Cree Two-Spirit artist, Kent Monkman. Kent Monkman has become very well known recently. He has two massive panels that were hung in the Museum of Natural History before we all went into COVID lockdown. There was supposed to be a big ceremony where the paintings were taken down, but he basically re-narrates the narrative of colonialism from the perspective of indigenous peoples. And in one of his performances, he draws upon, and he does this in much of his work, he draws upon Western painting of indigenous people, like George Catlin's painting, his one called Dance to the Badash. And in an early piece, Kent Monkman, he saw this painting and he decided he wanted to recreate it. Okay, and the dance to the Badash, he decided to recreate it as a performance. He installed it in the Montreal Museum of Fine Art. I can't remember the date of this, do I say? No. And he displayed the painting by Caitlin from 1891 on five screens, and then his alter ego, Miss Chief Eagle Testicle, did a performance that was supposed to recreate the dance of the Badash. And as you know, Badash is a term for a two-spirit person used often by settler colonials. And George Catlin, when he did this painting, he made the comment that nothing was more grotesque than seeing this dance by a tribe. And he was so disgusted with it, and yet he paints it, right? So Monkman comes back to this painting and decides to re-perform it. The choreography, he says, was created by Canadian Cree actor, choreographer, and dancer Michael Gray Eyes, and it was based upon traditional powwow and contemporary dance. And here is Kent Monkman in his alter ego of Miss Chief Eagle Testicle. And then finally, and here's the connection to Rite of Spring, the description of the piece on the website informs the reader that, quote, the music, written by Toronto composer Phil Strong, is a free syncopated version of Stravinsky's Rite of Spring, a modern masterpiece also inspired by ancient tribal rituals. Okay, so we come back full circle to an indigenous artist taking back some of the elements that made Rite of Spring so unwatchable and unlistenable to modernist audiences in 1913. He takes it back and he recreates both the ballet and the music that accompanies it. And this is very much in keeping with Monkman's ideology, because Monkman believes that nothing original happens in modernism that isn't already extracted from indigenous cultures. And he has one painting that's a hilarious depiction of Jackson Pollock. And Pollock is sort of sitting by a stream, and there are all of these indigenous craft makers, and Pollock's paintbrush drips onto a piece of canvas. And this is set up in relationship to some indigenous art making practices. But it's Pollock who is seen as the originator of abstract expressionism, despite the fact that abstract expressionism can easily be found in all kinds of printmaking practices among indigenous peoples. So this taking back, you can also see it. Here's one of his canvases in case people are interested in his painting. This one from 2003 is called Artist and Model. And it's a reminder that painting is an erotic exercise. So here you have a native person painting in pictograph form an image of a cowboy who's clearly aroused, but is also sort of pictured as a victim with these Saint Sebastian arrows coming out of him. And even though the native person is painting it as a pictograph, there's also a native person who has painted the entire thing. So modernism is recontained by an indigenous aesthetic that claims that modernism is derivative of indigenous practices. Okay, and that's the bewilderment that I'm interested in, this aesthetics of bewilderment that reverses the logic of who influences who, reverses the logic of progress that sees modern as the developed version of what was once indigenous, a complete reinscription of aesthetics, of noise, of harmony, and cacophony. And so this image, just to conclude then, this image by Monkman combines camp and cacophony to produce a counter-narrative of conquest. And I wish I had an image of Keith's Rite of Spring. I don't. I have this Bill T. Jones and Anne Bogart performance of Rite that I saw in 2013. Not as experimental as I thought it would be. Turns out Keith's is much more so. And I promised you the dinosaurs. Here they are. Of course, Disney didn't probably think about what he was doing, but the dinosaurs in that cycle in Fantasia stand in for the native peoples who are supposed to just evolve out of existence the way that the dinosaurs do, right? And we'll end then with another final quote against the backdrop of the dinosaurs by Jacques Rivière. Like animals tirelessly pacing in their cages, and here I think you can find the connection to Keith Hennessy's Bearskin, like animals tirelessly pacing in their cages and coming up to touch the bars with their foreheads, they carry it around with themselves without understanding it. These beings, in Rite of Spring, have no other organ but their entire organism. With it they seek, they move, here, there, stop. They hurl themselves like a wave and wait. There is nothing that has preceded their existence, nothing that must overtake, no ideal to recover. If we stay with them, we have already gone the whole way. Jacques Rivière. End of his review. This is an insane review. So just to say, what Monkman is doing is, along with this ecstatic review by Rivière, is reversing the gaze, transforming the meaning of wildness out of the opposite of civilization and turning it into a kind of queer refusal of the logic that modernity sets in motion.